to see all of y'all this morning. It's good to be seen. It's a beautiful day again. Pollen's flying. My eyes are itchy. But it's springtime's coming and summer's shortly behind. So it's good to be out and about. Let's open our service with a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day that we can come into your house to worship. We thank you for those that are here today, Lord. We thank you for their life, their presence, their love. We ask that you continue to bless each one here. Bless the speaker as he brings us the message today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, I am supposed to do birthdays. John, you got a birthday?
Yeah.
You know what? This coming Friday.
Right.
You'll be 84.
Right.
Woo.
Man. No, 48.
I'm 48. Okay. You know, Howard uses that line. Yeah.
I've already got that for you.
Yeah, but see, I jumped 10 years prior from 38 to 48.
There you go. Excellent. Well, we're going to sing next.
We've got Judy, Joanne, and Walter.
Yeah, that's right. Joanne, lucky, her birthday is Thursday. And Walter. And Judy. All right, we'll sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Any anniversaries? Okay. No anniversaries. Well, if you have your bulletin, let's look at our announcements for the coming week. Of course, tomorrow night is the Men and Women's Fellowship. Now, the men have met, and due to the pastor being out of town and I'll be out of town, we have decided to cancel the Men's Fellowship. But the women are supposed to meet tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Is that still taking place?
Still taking place.
Okay. All right. Good. Of course, then we have the Wednesday night adult Bible study, and I believe the pastor will be back for that. Sound right?
Yeah.
Okay, and the Wednesday youth class with Pastor Gunner. Any other announcements? Pickles are still for sale. Don't forget that. We still have some. We're getting low, so need to keep it in mind if you want some. Just let one of the men know we have some in storage in the back. If you forget and you're out during the week, I have some at my office. You can stop by and get some there. Okay. Anything else? All right. Since my wife does the bulletin, she told me I had to read one of these that she put in here, so I'm going to do that. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Colossians, and whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Okay. Let's start our service with hymn number 210, He Lives. Yes, and if you have your bulletin, the words to the next one. He Lives is 210. All right.
Just the time I need him, he's all.
crucifixion leading up to it and after that. And, you know, the two who left, that had left Jerusalem, and Jesus appeared to them, and not, they didn't recognize him at first. You know, I actually went to that place where they sat and ate. And, you know, we were in a bus as we left, and it, you know, it said it's just a few miles out of Jerusalem. Well, let me tell you, in a bus, it was about a 20-minute ride. And they walked everywhere they went, right? Yeah. And so anyway, the ruins are still there of the place that supposedly that took place. And again, very moving experience to be there, read the scripture. And actually at that place, you can see the Mediterranean. It's still elevated because Jerusalem is one of the highest points in Israel. And so as you go down west from Jerusalem, you're coming down and you can actually see the Mediterranean. It's a beautiful place where they sat with Jesus and recognized him during at the meal as they broke bread. Other praises or prayer requests. I have a prayer request. My good friend, Michael Holt, he's married to Sherry. He is, this week is to be appointed a circuit court judge. He's currently a family court judge. He learned that he has rectal colon cancer. And he begins his first treatment tomorrow, and supposedly stage 4. And Michael's probably 54, 55 years old, has a daughter in college, and his son's in high school. Wonderful family, very active in their church. And of course, they're asking for prayers as he begins his treatment. And again, they're putting their faith in God, but talking with him, you know, it's first of all very shocking for him, and he's very apprehensive. So keep the whole family, Michael Holt, and he's on the back of our bulletin, but keep him in the prayers. Other prayer request. Yes, ma'am.
My co-worker, Catherine, was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis a few years ago. And before COVID hit, she was scheduled for knee replacement, and she's had to put it off for a whole year. So she's finally going to have it done next week, the week after next. And so she's a young woman with a young child, and so she's going to need prayers for recovery and help with her child.
And you said Kathleen?
Catherine.
Other prayer requests. My family will be traveling this week, all of my family from different areas, so prayers for safe travel. Other prayer requests. How about upraised hand for unspoken requests? Let's go to the Lord in prayer this time. Father God, we again come to you in prayer. We thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you for your healing touch. We thank you for your son who came and rose from the dead. We thank you for that sacrifice for us all. Lord, we thank you for this place that we can come and worship, in this country that we can worship in. We thank you for a place of Hartsville. We thank you for this church family and the love that we share. We ask you to continue to bless this mission as we continue in our service to the Lord. We ask that you be with our pastor and his family as they are away and that they travel. Lord, you've heard spoken requests for those you also know in our hearts, and you can see our request in our bulletin, Lord. We ask that you reach out and touch those that are in need, that you be with those that need comfort, that you bless and heal, Lord. We ask now that you be in this service today, Lord. We ask that you bless our speaker as he comes to us. Give him the message that his heart has for us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our speaker today, of course, is listed in your bulletin. It's Mark Davis. Mark was in law enforcement over in Lee County and retired in 2016. Yeah. He attends the St. Andrew's Church of God, which some of you know where that is. It's on the other side of Bishopville, I guess the west side of Bishopville, more or less. I grew up going to church camp meetings there, and youth conventions were there, and it was always a fun place to go. But he, after he retired, started looking for things to do, and he tried his hand in a few part-time jobs, but those things kind of didn't go the way that he was led to go, and now he does speaking. And so we have Mark here today to speak to us, and Mark, we appreciate you being here. Thank you.
It's always good to be anywhere. Isn't that right? Good to be anywhere. What a time. And I saw Carl getting out of the car. I think I know him. I think we held him in contempt of court a few times.
They actually did. They locked me up on him.
No. Not really. He didn't come over there very often, but I remember he's always a very professional and very very good attorney, representing clients and everything. And I think I remember Michael Thompson. I really do not think so. The name is familiar. Always a pleasure. I said I retired in law enforcement in 16. I worked for my nephew, and he sold his business. And then I knew grandchildren were... My daughter was getting out of the military, and three grandbabies were coming my way, so I decided to get my hip fixed. And then after a couple of months after that, I said, I got to do something, get out of the house, because the wife and the grandchildren are killing me. And so I had worked part-time at a place in Bishopville called Crossroads Outdoors, a little place owned by Jake Smith, and a little hunting and fishing store. I'm there about 15 hours a week when they're real desperate. I'm there 20, and that's about good. That's good. I like that. That's about as much as I want to really work. And I've pastored before. I pastored bivocational for quite a few years, and I've been a member of St. Andrew's. That's where my wife's from. Interesting story. I'm from Ulysses, Kansas, Grant County. I graduated from Ulysses High School. My wife is from Lee County and graduated from Robert E. Lee Academy. So you just go and figure out the rest. leave that up to you. And she would be here today, but this has been a tough year. It's been the last week and a half for our family. Some of you might know Miss Ann Kelly from camp meeting and everything, and she'd been doing really well and in the early stages of dementia. And then last week she had blood pressure problems. Then she got where she got really dizzy and she couldn't get out of bed or anything. So we sent her to the doctor, and they sent her home with medication, serious case of vertigo, and she still can't get up and everything. So my wife has been tending to her, taking care of her, getting her up and about, and you know, trying to keep her going and everything. So remember Miss Kelly in your prayers. And but it's just a interesting times, but exciting times. You know, the Lord will continue to work and do anything. And I amen your thing with allergies. I promise you, I'm going to have to stick very close and look at my notes. Really hard today. I went to get my eyes checked here a couple of weeks ago. Well, my eye doctor no longer takes my insurance, so I gotta go somewhere else. I haven't been done in a while. And then the allergies, my eyes are so irritated. And then just last week, I mean, literally right next door to us, I mean, like from my garage to that back door back there, they started logging. Mm-hmm. And my eyes are just so irritated right now. I can't half see or anything, so just bear with me. I even brought this to slide along my notes so I don't lose my place if possible. But, and so we've been active in St. Andrew Church of God for the last couple of years and everything, and fill in different places, wherever. Just recently had to fill in a couple of weeks for our pastor. He had COVID. And his wife then, as soon as he got well, she had it, so they were in quarantine for a while and everything, so. But, you know, church keeps going. It's not, we're not where we were, but we're still here. And we have a lot of opportunities, many, many opportunities. And I think the Lord has shown many, many ways that we can continue to minister and everything. This morning, I want us to look at a passage of Scripture. We'll read it, and then we'll just kind of go through it as I go along this morning. But it's taken from Acts chapter 1, beginning with verse 3 and just going through verse 11. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for your many blessings. And Lord, we thank you for your scripture, and we thank you for the lessons that we can learn, and for the opportunity we have to read your word and pray over your word and discern your word and for your word to speak through us. And we ask you now to speak through your word, for it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Now what? Easter was last Sunday. Now what? Now what? What do we do after Easter? What happens after Easter? What do? You know, of course, our Easter services haven't been quite what they were before. Understand that. But it still doesn't change what happened with Easter and why we celebrate Easter and everything. And we look at the church year. You think back just before Christmas, we have Advent. And you're preparing for the birth of Christ. And then we have the Christmas when we celebrate the birth of Christ. And then you kind of go through a little there where you study about Christ and his teachings. And then a short time later, we come to Lent, the Lenten season, where we spend time in preparation for the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ. And then we have the actual death and resurrection. We have the actual Easter and everything. Then comes Pentecost, which is, I think this year will be on May 23rd, I believe. I'm not 100% sure, but I think that's calculated right. And then that's when the indwelling of the Holy Spirit came in to the followers of the church. And we talk in the church about the Holy Spirit and everything. And basically, Pentecost is what's considered to be when the church, the traditional church as we know it now, began. And as you know, he's been over there to Holy Lands and everything and seen all these places. I've never had that privilege to do that, but I've talked to many people. Sometimes I feel like I've been there. I've seen slides and shows and visited with many people. And as a matter of fact, just lost a dear friend to COVID that had been there several times. And some of you may know Mr. Wiley Alexander. I don't know Mr. Wiley, if you knew Wiley. He was a classmate of my wife and just a dear friend. I worked with his wife, his mom, for many, many years, and it was tough. But he had been there many times, and we would sit down and talk, and he'd share his stories and everything. And it was always such a pleasure to be around. So Easter is just a step in the process. It's not the end result. It's important that we understand this concept, that we don't just sit back and take it easy. That now that Easter is over, there are things to do. There is a process. We've gone from the birth to the death to the resurrection. So now we're, well, there's another important step to come. And here's the deal. Jesus' death upon the cross and his resurrection does not save the human race. Does not save the human race. But what it does is a means by which we can be saved, in which we are saved. So, him hanging on the cross, and he shouts, "It is finished." What's finished? What's finished? Everything that needs to be done so that people can be saved. Basically, it's the plan of salvation. The job of taking that plan to the world is for us. For us. We are the plan to take it to the world. We are the plan to share the message. Just like the apostles, and he shares with the disciples that, you know, he told them to go out and preach and teach and everything. And that's our job. And then like major corporations and businesses and schools and whatever it might be, there is no plan B. We are the plan. We are the plan to carry that word. So it's important. It's a job for you and I. Look at John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. So that, what does it say? Everyone who believes in him may not perish but have everlasting life. Whoever believes, Jesus offers us the plan, but we have to accept it. We have to accept it. Jesus offers us the people outside these doors. You know, it used to be back in the day, churches had the fire and brimstone revivals and everything, and people flocked to churches and services went on and on for days on days, and people came to know the Lord at church, but they had to be invited by someone. But those days it's not like that anymore. This plan of us taking is even more important. The church is outside these doors. We are to be the church outside these doors and to carry this message. We are the tool by which this is to happen. We are the tool he uses. So today is the day that we should all run out the door and jump into action. Yes? No? Not exactly. Not really. Because as we were looking here in Acts, and if we read what it says, you'll see what I mean, beginning at verse 3. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And on one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about." Okay, what is the gift? What is Jesus talking about? It's the Holy Spirit. He's talking about Pentecost. At Pentecost, they're going to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. He's telling them to, you know, slow down, wait a minute. And I love that when I read here, the fact that Jesus first and foremost came to the disciples with convincing proof that he was still alive and he was living. He had been resurrected and he was getting ready to leave them again. He was preparing them. He's about to put the plan of salvation into their hands. And he wants to make sure that they are up to the task, that they are ready for the task. And Jesus does the same today. He prepares us. He wants to make sure we're ready for the task. He knows that the task of sharing the plan of salvation has been placed in our hands. He is not going to send us out without making sure that we are up to the task. And we could get into how to go out and how to share and everything. And my simple thing is just share your story. Share your story. What Christ has done for you. To start with, just what's Christ done in your life? Just share your story with someone. You don't have to quote thousands of scriptures and you don't have to speak in theological terms. Just simply tell your story of what has happened. But that's for another day. But we have to look at the convincing proofs and we have to be ready to accept them. And you know, there are many people that don't want to accept the resurrection, that it is true. But it is. And if it is true, and it is, then you can't, your life can never be the same. It can never be the same after Easter, after the resurrection. So today we encounter our Christ in a different way than the disciples first did. You know, the disciples, they met with Jesus. They walked with Jesus. They were with him day in and day out for about 3 years. And now we encounter the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives with us. We don't just walk up and walk the road with Christ, physically, visually, like they did. But he has his teaching, he has his spirit that he gives us to share and everything. So Jesus himself shows himself to the disciples, to, you know, convincing them. And we would like to think, we would like to think that after all the time they spent with him and all the proofs and after all the miracles they saw, and then even after the resurrection, the times he came, that they would just run out and get to work. But that's not what happens. It's not what was planned. Look at the end of verse 4. Jesus tells them to wait. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait until the Holy Spirit arrives. Why? Why? Well, they needed some time. They weren't quite ready. Have you ever needed some time? I needed some time this week, and I didn't have a lot of time this week because I was planning on having a lot of time and a lot of quiet time this week. But my daughter, she lives next door in Kershaw County, brought her 3 babies over so she could help her mama and everything. So it's been chaos in the house. You know? And I'm talking a 4-year-old and twin 3-year-olds. So, you know, there wasn't a lot of quiet time and peaceful time and time to get in the God's Word and study and prepare like I would have liked. But it was fun. It was exhausting. But it was fun, and it's a joy and a pleasure, you know, and there's nothing like it. But it wasn't, when it first happened, the first time they came, I wasn't ready. I wasn't prepared. I didn't know how to deal with it. Right now, these guys, you know, they're not really ready for what's happened to them. They're still trying to absorb it all in and take it all in. They had walked with this man. They had seen him crucified, and then they'd seen the empty tomb, and now he's showing up and he's talking to them and sharing them, giving them proof that he has been resurrected. And he's telling them to wait. They weren't quite ready to get going, but wait. They need a little more time just to stop and let it all sink in. We've all needed time to let things just kind of sink in and be more prepared. They'd been traveling, observing his miracles, learning how to be his leaders, servant leaders, and they had just witnessed the greatest miracle of all. But they needed some time. They needed some time to take it all in. They needed the Holy Spirit to take over guiding them. They needed to learn how to let the Spirit lead them. Christ wasn't going to be there to physically tell them what to go and do anymore. He wasn't going to be with them in person. So now they were learning something new. And how do I know, you know, when you talk about the Spirit, how do I know if it's God leading me in this or that direction? And that's probably one of the greatest reasons Christians don't get out there. They're concerned that, well, maybe I'm not in the Spirit. Maybe I don't know. Maybe I don't know if the Spirit's guiding me or leading me. If you're feeling a nudge, or a guide, but if someone comes to your mind in prayer or anything, then the Spirit's leading you. He's leading you. And I tell people, even if he's not leading you and you're going about doing his work, probably some good things will happen. You know, maybe he didn't specifically send you to that person. But then again, how do we know? Because circumstances aren't always circumstances. Some things don't just happen because they just happen. They happen for a reason. But they needed the Holy Spirit to take over guiding them. They needed to learn how to let the Holy Spirit lead them. They had to learn this. So it's the same today. We live in a hurry-up society. A hurry-up society. And I don't know, has it changed the last year? No, I don't know. I can't really tell. I don't think it has. I know one thing. People drive a lot crazier now than they did a year ago. There's a new law on the books. Did you know that? You must pass on a yellow line. You must pass on a yellow line. It just never ceases to amaze me, the people that go by. Of course, maybe they didn't go by me before because I was driving in a patrol car or something. I don't know. Yeah, but I have had people pass me on the double yellow line when I was in a patrol car too. And I would pull them over and ask them, are you going to a fire or something? But wrote very few tickets. I was a nice officer. I was a kind officer. But I just stood there and talked to them for a long time. So if they were late, they were going to be later. And they would say, well, I'm late. And I said, yeah, you're late. So you're late. I mean, you're already late. I was sorry, you know. And I could tell some stories, but I won't. All right, moving on. But how do we know God? It's the same for us today. We live in this hurry up society, and like someone was talking about this morning, driving down the road and seeing the beauty and everything. Sometimes we're going so fast, we miss the beauty. I came the back road, and I came through Kelly County. I haven't been up this way in a long time. I hadn't been outside. I hadn't been north of Bishopville in a long time. Because I was driving this morning and saw they're building a church, new church, just outside of town. I didn't know that. I live on the south side of Bishopville. I come into town, and I go home, and I go to Kershaw County in the country where my daughter and her babies live and everything. That's kind of my span of what I do. Once in a while, I venture to something, or maybe Florence. I'll venture to something or more now because my son has moved. He opened in a Hobby Lobby there. He just opened a Hobby Lobby there. He'd worked at the one in Florence for many, many years. So now we can go to Hobby Lobby and something and everything. And I know women don't like to go to Hobby Lobby. Well, I've never been to Hobby Lobby. I don't know. You know, no. It's kind of neat. I like to walk around. I just don't like to take anything out when I leave. But it's a new place. But we live in this hurry up society. And talking about Hobby Lobby, I mean, you walk in there, Labor Day, in August, July, after July 4th, the Halloween decorations start showing up. And before Halloween's over, in September, Thanksgiving decorations stop showing up. And about the time you get into Halloween, Christmas starts showing up. And we're in a hurry to bring things along. And we don't even have the turkey out of the oven, and we're putting up Christmas decorations and everything. And the day our kids are born, and we're researching where the best school, the kindergarten, to send them to. And then we're trying to figure out how to get them through school a year or two faster and get them on to the best college or this or that. But we need to slow down. We don't want to miss out on the nuggets that Easter provides us with and that the Christian life provides us with. We're always... And the disciples here, they didn't get it either. We hear it in the Word. Look at verse 6. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And it doesn't say this, but guys, get over it. It ain't happening like that. That's not what this is about. And Jesus was patient. And it's a good thing because he has to have some sense of humor to go through what he went through. But I'm thankful that he was patient. I don't know. I have a tendency to probably try his patience and everything, but I'm sure some of you have tried the Lord's patience at times. But for 3 years, they had been following him. He'd been teaching them about the kingdom of heaven and everything. And I mean, I think back to the time, you know, when he was on the boat and the storm came up and he's down there asleep. What happened? Lord, don't you care? Wake up, man. Come on, now we're going to die. Okay, what's he? All right. See, calm down. Storm, calm down. It's okay. They were going to die. They were with him. It wasn't going to happen then. And then, you know, but we're kind of the same way. We get all panicky when things aren't going quite like we think it should go. But he'd been showing them how to serve, how to love their enemy. They're still stuck on the idea of, what about the kingdom? When are you going to return? But we're a lot the same. We get wrapped up in what we want God to do and how we want God to do it and how we want this done and that done. And that, you know, we want it this way and that way. And Jesus he wants to restore the kingdom of David. He wasn't going to overthrow the Romans and give them back to Israel. We got all that stuff, but you fast forward now, and the church is still the same. And any of you have ever listened to WMHK or anything? Anybody listen to that? Anybody listen to that? There's a song by Casting Crowns. It talks about a rock star preacher and everything. I don't know. It's I can't remember. The time is now or something like that. Look it up, the lyrics. That's all. I punched in the lyrics for a song with rock star preacher. That's about the only thing I remember. But read the lyrics of that song and everything. And it's so true. We're all guilty that we're trying to make this happen, make that happen, instead of just following the lead. Just let him lead. Flat out, look at verse 7. He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Jesus is telling them, you have a chore to do, and it's not sitting around worrying about when you're going to heaven. We don't know. We don't have a clue. We do not have a clue. And, of course, I don't know about you, but this last year, and especially when COVID first started, I started thinking about death again. Anybody you all thought about death any of this year? When this thing first hit, I was scared. Were you scared? Yeah, the media scares you and everything. And it's still a dangerous thing. And I've lost two dear friends. One was in his 30s, a co-worker of mine and everything, and Wiley. And then there's other family members and different people from, you know, relatives and everything. But, and I can look back at different people. And it was scary, but it was scary because we just didn't know. We're learning more about it and everything. But, you know, there's always been things we didn't know. And as long as we live, there's always going to be things that we don't know. But we know that if we know that we are in Christ, then it's going to be okay. He's going to take care of us. You know, he talked about answering prayer and everything. And I like that. I like that Garth Brooks song, that some of God's greatest prayers are unanswered prayers. Well, they're not unanswered prayers. They're just answered in a different way than we thought they would be answered, or hoping they would be answered. But the Holy Spirit, He comes on you, and you will be my witnesses, and everywhere. And that's the plan. We are to be the witnesses. And as long as we're able, and we're upright, and we can talk and speak, and we can move about, then we're to be the witnesses. We're to share with people. Like, we are the plan. And I used to try to make it difficult. And I had a pastor a few years ago, and he said, you know, just share your story. Share your story, what Christ has done in your life. How many of you have been healed of something? Anybody here been healed of anything? That's part of your story. How many of you had surgery last year? Anybody? Well, I had surgery right when they opened it back up. And let me tell you something. It's not fun. It wasn't fun then. My wife dropped me off at the hospital, and they said they would call her. You know? And I miss my wife today. I mean, she's almost always been with me when I speak and everything, but not today, just other things. But that wasn't fun. That was kind of scary. And I had my mask on, and they stuck me in this little room, and I laid there and laid there and laid there, and about once an hour somebody would come in and check my blood pressure and pulse and ask me how I was doing. And they had, of course, they had their mask on. I had my mask on. I was in a room all alone. There was nothing else there. I don't know why I had to have a mask on, but I had to have a mask on. And I'm thinking, I don't really like this. But the Lord took care. He watched over me, and eventually my wife got to come and get me and take me home. And that was a good thing. But it was, you know, things change, times change. But the disciples needed a little more time to focus. They just needed a little more time to figure it out. You're not quite ready. You will see the power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Then you will get it. You will be witnesses. But for now, wait, reflect, listen, go to your room, have prayer time, devotion. That's what he's telling us. This time now, from Easter to Pentecost, we can do the same thing. Take some time to reflect, to really get into the Word, to really study and really prepare. And then in a short time, we can get back out there and go at it again. It doesn't mean we stop now, but just sometimes we need to refuel, you know? We need to get filled again, need to move back on. Now, on moving on, he told them, don't do anything. Don't do anything. Just stay where you are. Wait. Be patient. And we don't like that. We don't like to be patient. Verse 9, after he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside him. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. I get to see him now. And I don't think we'd have been any different. We'd have probably been standing there too, like, wow. Did you see that? I think I would have been. I'd have been in awe, wouldn't you? I mean, they had just witnessed him depart. I mean, wow. And I think I'd have been standing there in awe too and everything like that. And he sends the angels. Okay, guys, it's time to move on. He left, and someday he'll return in the same manner. Someday. We don't know the day, and we'll never know the day unless we're here for that day. And we will never figure it out. I don't know, but some of you are a little older than me, some are a little younger than me, but how many times have you heard someone predict the end of time? Quite a few. And as far as I can tell, it hasn't ended yet. You know, we're still here. No one knows. So it's nothing to, you know, it's going to happen, but live life and share and move forward. So they returned to Jerusalem to wait and everything, and maybe we see our answer to now what. They all joined constantly in prayer, and for us, as much as I would love to stand up here and say, what are you waiting on? Get out there and share Christ with the people. I'm learning that this period after Easter is a time to do the same, to think about what we've experienced at Easter, to think about what it really means, and to reflect and to pray and discern. And I have another question. Have you let Easter change your life? Or did Easter only change your day? I hope Easter changed your life, not just your day. What did Easter do for you? Are you the same today as you were a few days ago? Or do you have a new excitement about Christ, a new feeling about who you are, a better understanding about who you would be if Jesus didn't travel to the cross? In closing, Billy Graham once said, the cross shows the seriousness of our sin, but it also shows us the immeasurable love of God. The immeasurable love of God. And that's really neat. I know a couple of weeks ago I was speaking and we were talking about the scripture, you know, we're talking about God before us, who can be against us. And that's something I like to dwell on too. God is for me. He is for me. Simple old Mark Davis. He's for me. I mean, wow. I mean, think about it. This is the creator of the universe, the beginning and the end. I'm sure you're a lot like me. I can't fathom all that. I just cannot take it all in. And have you ever been around people and they look at you, how can you be so peaceful about this right now? Because you have that peace that passes understanding. It's hard to explain it to people, but people see it. How can you be so calm in this dire situation? Jesus gives me that peace, that peace that passes understanding. Why did Jesus have to die on the cross? Because we were so covered in sin that we were not even worthy of the crumbs from beneath the table. But God is a God of mercy, of love, of forgiveness. No matter how bad you think you are, no matter what you have done, no matter what's in the past, the cross is even bigger. And God's love and forgiveness covers it all. We just can't know this. We have to own it. We have to claim it and be changed. And you probably heard this story last week or the last couple of weeks too, but I like to think of the thief on the cross. The thief on the cross. Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. And he tells him, today you will be in paradise. Think of that. Man, we have that promise that one day we'll be in paradise. And I love my life here on this earth. And I can't even imagine what that's going to be like. I don't have a foggiest clue or anything, and it's exciting to know. And you know, God has a lot of plans for the church and everything. And we are the plan. And in this past year, what's the one thing that's impressed me is the church has figured out a lot of other ways to minister. You know? A lot of other things to do. And the Facebook thing. In our church, we did some drive-by things. We did a virtual Bible school, and we had them drive by, and we had a station where they picked up their packets and everything. And we had people that came to that church that never even came, brought their children to Bible school and things. And we had some other drive-through activities where we'd have little stations and stuff. And it was amazing that people that showed up, people just out of the woodwork. They had nothing to do with the church or any church. And they were so thankful that someone that took the time to do something for them and for their children or whatever it might be. And it was amazing the little things that they were simple little things. But a lot of unchurched people were coming to them because they were just looking for something. Anything. Something. You know? And we have that hope. I think that old man, we have a hope that lives within us. Far beyond the grave or something like that. You know, we don't sing those old hymns at St. Andrew's much anymore. We sing all the contemporary songs. But we did just start a traditional service. We're doing two services now. And I love the old hymns. I love the new traditional songs. So take this time and make sure Easter has changed you, but make sure to spend the time and understand what God has in store and what his plan is for us. I mean, he wants us to share his message and just think about it. Soak it all in and then be strong. Fight the good fight. And I know some of you have been fighting the good fight a long time. A long time. And I'm glad you're still fighting the fight. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your many blessings. Lord, we thank you for the time after the crucifixion, after the resurrection. Lord, we thank you for this time when we can take it all in. We can get refreshed. And Lord, we can be open to your Spirit and let your Spirit in. Open our hearts so that we can stay in tune and in touch with what you have in store. And you have so much in store. I thank you for this and just give you all the glory and praise. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hymn number 514.
Hymn number 514.
Because I love thee.
for being here. I know each of us received a blessing. Let's close our service with a word of prayer. Father God, we again thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for this place that we can gather together. We thank you for this Christian family, for the love that we share. We ask that you watch over us during this coming week, keep us safe, and bring us back at the next appointed time. In Jesus' name, amen.